So before that, let me put two questions to you. Number one is, who are the kind of people you communicate in your workplace? Please free to respond through the chat box, or you can also unmute your microphone and respond. Who are the people with whom you communicate in your workplace?
Students.
Yes, ma'am. Students.
Colleagues.
Your colleagues. Can you just narrow down? Colleague is a broad term. So colleague, when we say that one who worked with us.
Parents.
Parents. Yes. We communicate with parents.
Vendors.
So Nagalakshmi ma'am says HODs. It's higher authorities says Gopivel sir. Yes sir. Yes. Our department staff, again from Nagalakshmi ma'am. Admin staff. Yes. Yes. So as non-teaching. Says Nagalakshmi ma'am. Thank you for these responses. To summarize, we talk with our students, head of the departments. As Gopivel sir said, it's higher authorities. We talk with them. We talk with parents, industrial persons, says Zakaria sir, I believe. Okay. So we talk with these people. Okay. The next question is, the platform you use to communicate with these people, of course, with students, oral communication in the classroom. So the platform we use to communicate with these people, so any mode or medium we use in order to communicate with people. Dhanlakshmi ma'am, she has raised her hand. Probably she can mute an email, mobile, okay, telephone. So email. WhatsApp, excellent. In person, yes.
I think all the social medias.
All the social medias, probably Instagram, Facebook, etc. Thank you. So these are the modes we use in order to communicate with the people in our organization as well as outside the organization. So with this background knowledge, let us move on to the session. Let me share my PowerPoint. Just a minute. Okay. So, so based on what you said, so let me first present the overview of my presentation. So in this session, I am going to cover these five topics. So one is, what is business communication and why is it necessary? That will be the first point to focus upon. Second will be types of business communication. Three, tips for effective communication. Four, email communication etiquettes. And finally, writing reports. So this email communication etiquette, I included this here because when the faculty members were asked to give suggestions regarding the topics. Okay, someone said they need a session on email communication etiquette. So we tried to include that in the business communication session. Okay, so writing reports is so email as well as reports. These are the most of often chosen medium by us to communicate within the organization as well as outside the organization. So let me first start with the definition of business communication. So from the word business communication, we understand that the communication that happens in a business environment must be business communication. So so in the workplace, so in the college, among our colleagues, when we talk, it is a business communication. And when we communicate with people outside the organization, Okay, that is also a business communication. Why do we do that? This is only to achieve our organizational goals. So if we learn to make effective business communication, we can easily achieve our organizational goals, and our work style will be very free, smooth, so that we can achieve our objectives with minimal errors. So that is the objective. So effective business communication helps us to achieve our organizational goals with minimal errors. So that is why it is very much necessary. So with this definition, okay, and based on the responses you gave to my two questions, okay, we can classify communication, that is business communication, into two, that is internal communication, external communication. So when we communicate with our higher authorities, with our students, so then it is an internal communication. But when we communicate with someone outside our organization, it is external communication. So internal communication you can further classify. So when as a faculty, okay, in this capacity, so when I communicate with my HOD, so that is higher official, HOD, dean or principal or top management, that particular communication is called as upward communication. So when I communicate to someone lower in rank, so when I communicate with my students, when we communicate with the secretary in our department, when we communicate with lab technicians, when we communicate with attenders, so they are all downward communication. So from here, it goes to people of lower rank. So it is downward communication. And third is horizontal or lateral communication. So that is the communication when between or among peers, that is fellow faculty, people of equal rank. So when I communicate with people of equal rank, it is horizontal communication. So external communication, so when we communicate with, as Zakaria sir said, industrial people or experts from industries. When we communicate with academia, that is faculty in IIT or IISc or any other institutions. So when we communicate with organization, DRDO or DST, when we communicate with people there, it is an external communication. So vendors from whom we procure lab equipment, so that is an external communication. When we communicate with the professional bodies like IIT, so then that is an external communication. When we communicate with Anna University, AICTE, NBA, NAC, so that is when we communicate with affiliating and accreditation bodies, it becomes external communication. So now I would like to show you a communication, and I want you to tell, is there anything wrong with this communication? Just read this communication and just let me know anything is wrong with this communication.
Dura sir. Dura sir. Duraj.
Can any one of you unmute and tell me whether there is anything wrong with this communication? Are you able to hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Vanithi ma'am, is there anything in the chat box?
No, ma'am.
Can any one of you respond? So the communication goes like this. I would like to talk to you about the new MOU proposal which the IIC members had discussed yesterday. I might need the help of Karthik from your team. So regards Sunil. This is one internal communication between two colleagues, that is Sunil and Rajiv. So do you find anything wrong with this communication, or you find this communication all right? So Nagalakshmi ma'am says there is no connection between the two sentences. Okay, so there is no connection. Okay. So any other point? So there is something wrong with this communication. That is what Nagalakshmi ma'am says. There is no connection. Anything else? So I personally feel that the writer has taken the reader for granted. Here it says, I would like to talk to you. So he says, the writer says he would like to talk to you, but did not bother to find out the appropriate time or when Rajiv will be free, or he did not give any time, mention any time specific, but he says he would like to talk to him. So it is not clear. So when he wants to, Sunil wants to talk to Rajiv, that is one. Again, we are not sure whether Rajiv is aware of the new MOU proposal. So we have taken it for the writer has assumed that he knows about new MOU proposal, the points the agreement or policies that are reflected in the agreement. So here, the writer takes the speaker for, reader for granted. Then he says which the IAC members attended. And we do not know whether Rajiv knows the expansion of IIC. So we do not know that. Main details missing, says Nagalakshmi ma'am. So IIC, whether he knows the expansion of IIC, whether Rajiv is part of IIC, we are not sure. And finally, I might need the help of Karthik from your team. So Karthik, names like Karthik, okay, there's many Karthiks may be there in the team. To which Karthik Sunil is referring to, we are not sure. So in this communication, we find that Sunil has taken Rajiv for granted and the communication is not clear. So in other words, main details are missing. So it is the communication is not clear. So let me move on. So reader, receiver is taken for granted. So Rajiv may not be aware of the new MOU proposal. So with whom they are signing the MOU, he may not be aware. He may not be aware of the agreements reflected in the proposal. He may not be aware of the expansion of IIC. He may not be part of IIC that attended the meeting. There may be many Karthik in Rajiv's team. Finally, Sunil has not asked Rajiv for the appropriate time to talk. So this communication lacks clarity. So when the third point, he may not be aware of the expansion of IIC. So this use of abbreviation, we need to be very careful. So if we take for granted that everybody will know the expansion of IAC, then there is more chance for miscommunication. So this reminds me of a story. I think I have narrated this story in some other point of time also. But for those who have not listened to it, I would like to repeat this. So this is about a Swiss lady. She wanted to visit country, India, and that was a time when internet was not popular or probably did not exist at all. So she had asked her friend to find an accommodation for her during her visit to India. And the friend has also found one or fixed one accommodation for her. Now the Swiss lady had a doubt whether the accommodation had a water closet or western toilet. So she wanted to confirm this with her friend. So she wrote to her friend and asked whether the accommodation has a WC. So she says whether the accommodation has WC, that is water closet, but she is not explaining it, she just writes whether the accommodation has got WC. Her friend was not able to figure out what WC is. So she went to a priest and asked what WC means. So after prolonged thinking, the priest said, WC must be wayside chapel. So WC is a wayside chapel. So the friend started writing a reply to the Swiss lady. Dear madam, WC is 20 miles away from your place. It will be a problem for you if you have the habit of going daily. So I would suggest you to go on Thursdays as there is an organ accompaniment. It is a very ancient building. Even the minutest of the sound could be heard by all. So when I narrate the story, you try to visualize the facial expressions of the lady. So you will be surprised to know that this is the place where my daughter met her husband and got married. And it was so crowded on the day of wedding that there were two people for one seat. And madam, if you are interested, let me know when you visit WC. I can find the best seat for you from where you could be seen by all. So this is the problem when you do not explain or expand the abbreviation. So while writing and while introducing abbreviation, the point to be noted is when you use it for the first time, use the expansion and within brackets you can give the abbreviation. And in the later part of your communication, if you want to use the same abbreviation, you can use the abbreviation at the later part of your communication. But when you introduce the abbreviation, see to that you give the expansion and then the abbreviation in the brackets. And so takeaway one is your communication should be clear. This is point number one. So let us move on to the next communication, a sample communication. So I have got two communications here. So what is your opinion about these two messages? So first one. So it says, literally humorous, thank you, Nagalakshmi ma'am. So hi everyone, I just wanted to send you all a reminder about the meeting we are having tomorrow. See you then. This is one communication. Communication two is, let us meet tomorrow to discuss AICTE sponsored international conference. Please be there on time. So Sadasivam sir says tomorrow should be mentioned with the date. Nagalakshmi ma'am says informal and formal. Never comes, yes, good observation. The communication one, never say that all must attend. Okay, good. Second one has better information, says Banurika ma'am. Yes, exactly. In communication one, when, where, what is not mentioned, excellent. So here I just wanted to send you all a reminder about the meeting. So when the meeting is, where the meeting is, and what the meeting is about. Okay, no information available. So good observation. And see you then. And any communication in a business, a situation should call for an action. So here, as someone said, yeah, let if see, I think Banurekha ma'am or someone. So there is no, what we should do is not clear. Whether we should attend, who has to attend, it is not mentioned. Okay. So never say that all must attend. So it doesn't say who should attend. So call for action is not there. Yes, as Banurekha ma'am said, the communication two is better than one. But of course, again, this is not a clear, or I can say complete communication. Let us meet tomorrow to discuss. So AICTE sponsored international conference. Okay, you are going to discuss on AICTE sponsored international conference. But when, where is not mentioned. Who has to attend is not mentioned. So is it okay to say that this these two messages, they are incomplete? So the communication one and two, they are incomplete. So next takeaway is that your communication must be complete. So it should not be incomplete and it should call for action. So let us see how it can be improvised. So it says, hi everyone, I just wanted to remind you about tomorrow's meeting, okay, on university result analysis. Of course, we can excuse because when it is an email, okay, so when date is there, we can always guess that tomorrow the date can be guessed. Meeting on university result analysis. The meeting will be at 10 a.m. at principal's conference hall. And the call for action is, please let me know if you can attend. See you then. The second one can be improvised like this. Let us meet tomorrow at 11 a.m. at conference room to discuss AICTE sponsored international conference. We will have to decide the keynote speakers. So in that communication, it was not said, the agenda is not mentioned. So we will have to decide the keynote speakers and complete the event invite draft tomorrow. Please be there on time. So call for action is mentioned. So takeaway number two is your communication should be complete. Number one is it should be clear. Number two is it should be complete. Completeness in communication. Let us move on to the third one. So now just read this communication. Dear Rajiv, I think we need to talk about, yeah, there is a query in the chat box. Someone asked that whether it is appropriate to use hi. Yes. So it is always hi followed by name. When you know the person, it is all right. So you can say hi, Jack, hi, Rajiv. So that is allowed in a formal communication, provided, so based on the relationship between you and the receiver. So if it's an unknown person, you cannot say hi. But if he is your friend or whom you know better, your colleague whom you know better, then you can say hi with the name. That is allowed. Okay, now here, so read this communication. So I think we need to talk about the corporate social responsibility initiative from our side. I mean the one which we need to do as a periodical exercise. I think it is a great way of building our brand image. Basically, it would just be a visit to an orphanage, but we can sort of do other things too. For instance, we could bring the kids to our institution and arrange horse riding on our campus. Let us sit and talk tomorrow. Regards, Sunil. So what is your opinion about this communication? So any idea? So Kavita ma'am says date and time is not there. Yes. date and time is not mentioned. Anything other than missing information you find here? So some information are missing, I agree. But anything other than this missing information? So here we find lot of words that are used unnecessarily. So you can communicate very well even without these words. I think, okay. So it is, we need to talk about the corporate social responsibility initiative. So we must see whether, yeah, wonderful question, Nagalakshmi ma'am, sit where, yeah. So initiative from our side, I mean the one which we need to do. Yeah, excellent sir, Sadasivam sir, I mean, I think, yes. So any other unnecessary words you are able to find? Basically, Banarekha ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. For instance, yes. So basically, it would just be a visit to an orphanage, but we can sort of do other things too, in my view. Yes, for instance, we could bring the kids to our institution and arrange horse riding on our campus. Yes, let us sit. As Nagalakshmi said, where to sit, why to sit, okay, and talk tomorrow. So unnecessary words, redundant words are used in this communication. So what is important is to communicate concisely, to communicate in a precise manner. That is what is important. So conciseness in communication. So you use less words and communicate. So I think we need, from our side, I mean the one which we need to do as a periodical exercise. I think basically it would just be, can sort of do other things too. For instance, let us sit and talk tomorrow. So in order to, so you can write this way, I need to discuss the corporate social responsibility initiative with you. Let us bring the kids this time to our institute and give them a horse riding experience instead of just visiting them. This will help enhance our brand image. We will talk in detail tomorrow. So when is also given here. So this is how you bring in brevity, precision in your communication. So takeaway three is be concise while communicating. So here again, I would like to tell you a story because this being a dry topic, I thought I can introduce some stories to you. Okay. So once there was a monastery where the monks took a vow of silence. That is, nobody was allowed to talk. But there was one exception that once in a year they can talk to their head monk, but there again only two words are allowed. Okay, so it is a strict monastery. And the monks there took a vow, that is vow of silence. They will not speak to anyone. Okay, and only once in a year, they are allowed to meet the head monk and speak only two words. So a new joinee monk, after completing 1 year, was invited for a meeting with the head monk. The head monk asked, so it is 1 year since you have come here. What are the two words you have got to say? The monk said, bed hard. He said, bed hard. The head monk said, thank you. So next year, again, this monk was called for the annual meeting with the head monk. Head monk said, now it is 2 years you have come here. What are the two words you have got to say? Mom said, food awful. Food awful, he said. Mom said, see you. Head mom said, see you. And he left. Yet another year passed. And third year, again, the monk was called, was invited for a meeting with the head monk. And head monk again said, it is 3 years since you have come here. What are the two words you have got to say? Monk said, I quit. So now the head monk said, I know why. You can only complain. So what is the connection between the story and communication here? That is that the more you say, the less the people will remember what you have said. So if you are concise, if you use less number of words to communicate, your words will be remembered for a longer time. So takeaway three is to achieve conciseness in communication. So let me tell you how to achieve this conciseness. To achieve conciseness, always use active voice, that is, give doer importance. So write an active voice more than passive voice. Use short, easy to understand words rather than long, obscure words. Don't circumlocute. If you can say something in a word or two words, it is better rather than using 4 to 5 words. Avoid overuse of adjectives, that is, descriptive words like nice, beautiful, amazing. Use weak qualifiers sparingly. So those weak qualifiers like sort of, rather, somewhat, how much ever possible you can reduce this usage, please do that. Avoid the repetition of words in the same sentence. Keep sentences on shorter side. Break up long paragraphs. So we make them into short paragraphs so that people can remember your message easily and they will be able to act upon it. So to act, third is to achieve conciseness. So can any one of you unmute and read this? So I want one of you to read this, unmute and read.
Mama, am I okay, ma'am?
Yes, ma'am. Manurika, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. It doesn't matter in what order the letters in a word are. The only important thing is that the first and last letter be at the right place. The rest can be a total mess and you can still read it without problem. This is because the human mind does not read every letter by itself, but the word as a whole.
Thank you, ma'am. Banarika, ma'am. Thank you very much. So you see that every word except for it, the first word or some prepositions or verbs, the main words, okay, almost all the words are written in with wrong spelling. We have retained only the first and the last letter and the other letters are jumbled. In spite of that, Banarekha ma'am was able to read it very fluently. She was able to read. So only at one place, miss, she found it a little difficult. But of course, she was able to manage it very well. So when there are some mistakes in our communication, particularly spelling error, it doesn't mean that we are ignorant of the spelling. So many times, you know, we underestimate the writer. It is not the case. So when we use devices like mobile phones, small devices like mobile phones, or when we have to respond to several other emails, or when we have piles of work to do, so when we type fast, we tend to make mistakes in spelling. It is not that we do not know. And we will be able to read it correctly and the reader can also read it correctly. Okay. So the communication is successful ultimately, but again, it speaks volumes about your reputation as well as reputation of your institute organization. So we must see to that there are no spelling errors. What suggestion I can give is that when we read, okay, at times we will be reading it correctly. So in that case, how we can avoid is My slide is not moving. Yes. So to achieve correctness in communication, use writing apps that points out spelling errors. So even if there is a wrong spelling, we tend to read it correctly. So it is better to use writing apps that points out spelling errors. Be conscious of using correct contractions with related to grammar. So U apostrophe R E, okay, or Y-O-U-A-R-E, Y-O-U-R, we make a lot of, we get confused in these areas, we make a lot of mistakes. Then mistakes in the agreement of subject and verb. And we may start with the present tense and continue with the past tense. So there will not be any consistency in the verb tense. These are all the mistakes we commit in the usage of grammar. So for which I advise you to use software like Grammarly. Okay. So that it autocorrects. Then, so not only with the mistakes in spelling, punctuations, grammar, give wrong facts. So avoid factual errors. So tip number four is correctness in communication. And in short, proofread. Now look at these sentences. I am slightly unwell. Interest rates have been marginally reduced. The expenditure of the company has reduced significantly during COVID-19. He maintains a good attendance record. Let us plan to meet in the near future. We hereby wish to let you know that our company is pleased with the confidence you have reposed in us. I felt very good. So what are your observations?
Ambiguous, more of
yes. Ambiguous. Hello, ma'am. Vanati, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. More of fussiness and ambiguous is there in the statements.
More of ambiguity is there in the statement. Very good, ma'am. So ambiguous, it is again not clear. Okay. So I am slightly unwell. So I am unwell. That is more than sufficient. Interest rates have been marginally reduced. It can be marginal for you, but it can be huge for me. So the expenditure of the company has reduced significantly during COVID-19. So what is the significance? 40% may be significant for you. Okay, 60% may be significant for me. He maintains good attendance record. Let us plan to meet in the near future. So when may a near future can be today afternoon, can be after a week also. We hereby wish to let you know that our company is pleased with the confidence which you have reposed in us. I felt very good. So good, how much good, we do not know. So that is when we ask the students, that is especially the third year students during mock interviews, okay. So what is your short-term goal or long-term goal? In spite of coming to the third year, they always say that I wanted to clear all my arrears or score good percentage and place in a good company. So we always, English teachers, we always say that this is very abstract, be specific. So don't give your goal like a first-year student. So we always say, you remember you are in the third year. You have to say that I wanted to get placed as so-and-so in this particular company. So you have to be very specific. So here, as Vanati ma'am said, it is very ambiguous. It is a vague, slightly, we do not know. It is the degree, we do not know. It is 99 or 101, we do not know. Marginally, significantly, good attendance, near future. So I felt very good. These are all ambiguous words. So next is, you have to be very concrete, very specific in whatever you say. So the next takeaway is concreteness. Your communication should be concrete. So it is like, I am unwell is more than enough. Interest rates have been reduced by 1%. Okay, this is very concrete. Expenditure of the company has reduced to 50% during COVID-19. He maintains 100% attendance record. Let us plan to meet by noon, or you can say let us plan to meet Thursday, this Thursday. we appreciate your confidence is enough. I felt like a cool breeze blowing. So you have felt the feeling of the cold breeze. Okay, so you can always relate what good is here in this case. So you have to be very concrete in your communication. So to achieve concreteness, use specific facts and figures. Put action into words. So we say we appreciate your confidence. Choose vivid image building words. So I felt like a cool breeze blowing. So people can imagine or understand the feeling of that goodness when you say cool breeze blowing. So this is how you achieve concreteness in your communication. So clarity, completeness, okay, then concreteness, and what are the other things? Okay, we will see to that later. Finally, I have a summary of all the C's. So now, there is another communication. I want to write to you a note about Kamalesh, who works in your department. He is a great asset. I would like to talk to you when you have time. So what is your observation about this communication?
Write a note as well as wanted to talk. Both are there now.
Ma'am, it is not clear.
Actually, I want to write a note about Kamalesh as well as I would like to talk, okay, talk to you when you have time.
Okay. Yes, ma'am, that is correct. So how do you relate it, ma'am? So you're right. So he says that I want to write a note about Kamalesh and I would like to talk to you when you have time. So very good observation, but can anybody say that maybe some kind of uncertainty in the message? Okay. There may be many Kamalesh, okay. So as ma'am said, he talks about one thing, that is to write you a note about Kamalesh. And then he immediately talks about some other thing that I would like to talk to you when you have time. So there is a coherence. I have given the tip. So coherence, it lacks coherence. So there is no logical connection between the first and the second sentence. So it lacks coherence. So it can be improved this way. I want to write to you a note about Kamalesh. So as Sadasivam sir says, who works in your department? Again, it can be, clarity can be given by as what, maybe technical assistant. In recent times, he helped in conducting Build to Learn workshop. Now, AICT has approved our proposal to conduct a workshop of similar kind, and the knowledge and skills of Kamalesh will be of immense help in conducting the workshop. Could we please have his help with this work? I would appreciate speaking about this with you. When is the best time to discuss this further? So in this you have coherence. So you say you wanted to write a note about Kamalesh. So you are giving a note about him, that he helped you in Build to Learn workshop. So then you come to the point, so the workshop AICT has agreed to sponsor and you need the expertise of Kamalesh in conducting that. And you request the team head to help in getting the assistance of Kamalesh. And you say, I would appreciate speaking about this with you. So when is the best time to discuss this further? So here I wanted to point out one common mistake we do when using discuss. So we always say discuss about. So it is a wrong coinage. So discuss, so we'll say when is the best time to discuss about this further. So discuss about is a wrong coinage. When is the best time to discuss this further is the correct coinage. So takeaway six is try to achieve coherence in your communication. So tip number seven, it is courteousness. So you be considerate of your speaker. So whoever you are, you may be a big person in your office, but when you communicate, you be considerate of your reader or listener. So here it is something you can imagine a situation that your HOD or someone is writing to the IT department, that is maybe, for example, Nipin's department, Mr. Nipin's department. So I really do not appreciate how your IT team ignores the request of my team alone. Probably there is a problem in your computer lab and you need the assistance or help of Mr. Nipin's team to rectify. But it so happens, it is not intentional, but Mr. Nipin is not able to send someone to set it right. So the HOD writes, or HOD or anyone in charge, they have lab in charge. I really do not appreciate, this is just an imaginary situation, don't personalize. I really do not appreciate how your team ignores the request of my team alone. My team is an important function in this organization too, and we have our own IT requirement. Can you ensure that your team responds promptly to my team's request henceforth? So how does this sound? So it sounds very rude, arrogant, authoritative, but you have to sound polite, okay, and decent, genuine while communicating. So it can be improvised this way. I understand that the IT team is swamped with work and gets requests from every department in the organization. My team, however, is working on a high priority project. So you don't say we do important. So we are working on a high priority project. And I would generally appreciate if you could ask your team members to respond to my team's queries promptly and help us complete this project on time. Please do let me know if you need anything from me. So this sounds better. So you are considerate about the reader. So tip seven is achieve courteousness in communication. So finally, to summarize, concluding the session. So to summarize the tips for effective communication, your communication should be clear, it should be correct, it should be complete, it should be concrete, it should be concise, it should be coherent, and finally, it should be courteous. So these are the tips for effective communication. So I gave you, so I just could have told your communication should be complete. I just wanted to illustrate that with sample communication. And so please bear in mind that your communication should have all these seven C's: clarity, correctness, completeness, concreteness, conciseness, coherence, and courteousness. So now we'll move to the next part of my session, that is email etiquettes. So we will see the do's and don'ts of email communication. Email etiquettes do's. Number one, do ensure that your email address is professional. This is what we have to tell our students first of all. So many have a fancy email address like Preeti is cute, contact cute Preeti, so something like that. So we have to tell our students that they should have an email address that is very, very professional. So it is better to have an email by your name, maybe your branch of study or... and nowadays, we even for students, we give official email ID. So better ask them to use those email ID for correspondence within as well as outside the organization. So the point is your email address should be professional. That is number one. Number two is do pay attention to the subject line. Okay, this is very, very important because only by seeing the subject line, people will read the message. So they will understand what the communication is about and whether it is relevant to them or not, whether it is the highest priority or not. So based on that, they will read your message. Of course, we do read certain messages, taking into consideration the sender of the message. So we tend to avoid certain messages from certain people, yes, but pay attention to the subject line. So when you write a subject line, you make it very brief. Don't have subject lines like hi, hello, touch base, FKYI for your kind information. So don't use such messages, subject lines. Similarly, do not put the complete message in your subject line. So some people have the habit of writing, framing a long subject line. So they would have conveyed the message in the subject line itself. That is also not correct. So you maintain a balance, pay attention to the subject line. Three, do use a proper salutation. So someone asked whether it is appropriate to use hi while salute. So you can say dear sir, madam, or dear so-and-so. You can say dear Jack. Or if the person is known to you personally, and if your relationship is very friendly, no harm in saying hi Jack, okay, even in an official communication. It depends on the person to whom you are writing. Do use a proper salutation. Do use an introduction. So you must know the culture of the person to whom you are writing. If he is an American, he would prefer you to introduce yourself with the first name as well as last name. So it is better, so when you are in an official communication, so you can say, dear Mr. Jack, I am so-and-so. So if you're American, use your first name. If the person is an American, use your first name as well as last name. So you introduce yourself and then proceed with the message. So this is in case of any external communication through email. Do choose your words carefully and thoughtfully. So in email communication, there is no chance or no scope to look at your face. The reader will not know your facial expressions. They will not know the tone in which you are conveying the message. So you must be very careful in the use of words. You have to choose the words carefully and thoughtfully. So this is where you can demonstrate your courteousness. So use words that conveys that you are very considerate about the receiver or the reader. Sixth, do double check your attachments. So sometimes, most of the times, in fact, I do this. So I have sent emails to people without attaching the files. Or sometimes we tend to attach wrong files. So before you hit the send button, you just check whether you have attached the file, whether you have attached the appropriate file. So that has to be made note of. Do double check your attachments. Next one, do consider who needs to be copied. So don't put CC to all. Okay, so you just understand whether the message is useful to them, relevant to them, and then you add CC to the person. So sometimes, certain people will have hidden intentions behind adding CC. Probably they would have thought of trapping you by adding CC to some official in the top management. So that may be intentional. People may do it intentionally also. So probably some failure on your part to respond, and they wanted to trap you by bringing it to the knowledge of the higher official. Sometimes people do that also in an official environment. So you must be careful about that. If Lady Luck is by your side, okay, and then in that case, that can turn as a fortune to you, okay. So if you work with right intentions, I feel that even if somebody tries to trap you, they will not be successful in their intention. So only if it is required to add somebody as CC, do that. So otherwise, don't do that. Only if it is relevant to that, you have to CC them. Otherwise, do not do. Don't CC people with wrong intentions to trap somebody. So that is not fair. So you, it sounds, you, it shows that you're very rude to the person. Do reply expediently. So it says, research says that you should be able to reply to an email within 24 hours. So do reply expediently. Number 9 is, do include your name or signature with additional details and contact information. So towards the end of the your email, so you use signature. So there, your name must be there, your affiliation to the organization, your position, designation, address of the organization, and the contact number can be given, so that your receiver, if based on the emergency or urgency, can call you over phone and also complete the communication. So these are all the do's. So have a professional email. So your subject line should be very specific, limited. Okay, do use proper salutation. Introduce yourself. While introducing yourself, be conscious of the culture. Do choose your words carefully and thoughtfully. Do double check your attachment. Do consider who needs to be copied. Do reply expediently, that is within 24 hours. Do include your name or your signature with additional details and contact information. So now let us move on to the don'ts. Email etiquette don'ts. Don't use email when another form of communication is more effective. For example, if you have to decide something in another half an hour or 1 hour, okay, don't send an email. So if you are calling for an urgent meeting in your office, don't send an email, and don't find fault with people saying that they have not seen the email. So in this case, when you are convening an urgent meeting, email is not the appropriate form of communication. So it may be telephone or in-person invitation will be more effective. So don't use email when another form of communication is more effective, even WhatsApp. So we cannot assure that people will be on WhatsApp 24/7. So you have to, so in that case, to convene an urgent meeting, you need to call the people and inform them. Even if they fail to pick up the call, if it is within the same organization, so you have, you can go in person and inform, or you can send your attender to inform the person. Don't use emojis in email communication, and particularly business communication. Don't write long email. So email is intended for short communication. So if you have to write a lengthy communication, so email is not the right choice. You have to go for writing letters. So don't write long emails. Don't be negative. Similarly, if you have to convey any information that is negative information, please don't write in email. So anything to be negative, again, you can call and speak to them, or you can go in person and convey. So don't be negative while communicating through email. Don't forward email without permission. So I know that we do this. So we forward email from someone without their permission. We do that. So ethically speaking, we are not supposed to do that. We have to get their permission, and only then you have to forward their email. Don't forward messages without explaining why it is being sent and what needs to be done. So this reminds me of a communication I received 2 years ago. So someone from the institute, okay, when we were busy with NAC or NBA work, So I received an email with an attachment. The communication was PFA. So it is only PFA and a format is attached. So what is the instruction there? Please find attached. So I scrolled down. I saw, I ensured that the file is attached and I kept quiet. So you must tell, so they have received the template. The person, the coordinator, must have received the template from the college coordinator. They just forwarded it with PFA. So what is said, what is the call for action there? Please find attached. So I found it attached and I kept quiet. So be clear. And similarly, you forward message you receive from someone and you say, please do the needful. What is needed? Who knows? God alone knows. You must know, or the person who forwarded must know. So I will not be knowing. Your receiver will not be knowing. So when you forward messages, okay, don't forward without explaining why it is being forwarded to you and what you have to do with that. Okay, so you have to be very clear when you forward somebody else's message. Don't use all caps to highlight your message. So we may think that this is a very important point. You wanted to draw the attention of the receiver. So what you write, what you do is you capitalize all the message, the sentence you capitalize. In email communication, if you capitalize the letters, it means you are very rude to them. You are angry with them. So don't use all caps to highlight your message. So find out some other, that is, you can highlight with a marker. You can do something of that kind, but do not all caps. Don't write that in a, type that in a capital letter. Okay, it means that you are very rude to them. You are angry with them. You are scolding them. That is the information you are conveying. Don't forget to check grammar and spelling. So before hitting the send button, proofread, check for grammatical mistake, spelling mistake. They may be unintentional, but remember, it speaks volumes about your reputation as well as the reputation of the organization you are in. Number 9, don't fill in the 2 lines until you have written and proof edited your message. This is only for our safety. So if you fill in the 2 address, okay, so accidentally if you hit the send button, even before you complete the communication, it would reach them. So it as a safety measure, so you before hitting the send button, when you are convinced that everything is perfect, so after confirming yourself, after ensuring, you can type the 2 address. Don't fill in the 2 lines until you have written and proofed, edited your message. So finally, you give the 2 address and then send. This is only a tip, it's a caution, that's all. Don't forget the conversation closer. So your email should call in for action. And you give your details, your name, your affiliation, the name of the institution, so your phone number, etc. So now I will just stop sharing my PowerPoint, and I would like to show you a video. So whatever I have told here, that is 19 points of do's and don'ts, okay? So that is reflected in the video. Okay, you can just watch that.
Downer, you going to that all day meeting tomorrow?
I'll be on vacation from Tuesday, June 27th until 2 days ago.
Your auto response is still on.
I'll be on vacation from Tuesday, June 27th until 2 days ago.
Okay, everyone, I need you to send me your reports ASAP before lunch if possible.
Will do, Trip. Will do, Trip. Will do, Trip. Will do, Trip.
Why are you including me in this?
We'll be there around 7 tonight, if that's okay.
Yeah, sounds good.
Kind regards, Trip Crosby. Regional Sales Manager. Work 404-555-6112, extension 405. Mobile 404-555-3767. Email trip@biz.dot. Success is always an option. John Maxwell, author.
Here's that report you needed.
I don't see anything.
Oh, dang it, I forgot to attach it.
Hey, Beth, did you see all the submissions we got today?
OMG, I know!
Easy on the all caps.
Sorry.
It's okay. Semicolon, close parenthesis.
Hey, son. You have to watch this video of this cat sleeping on a horse. It is so cute.
Mom, I'm at work.
Dear friend, I am Johnson Emmanuel. This might come to you as a surprise. I'm the next heir to the throne in Nigeria, and I want to offer you a large sum of money.
Please stop coming here.
Hi, Trip. Are you satisfied with...
Hi, I'm the administrator. I could not deliver this document. It was too big. On Monday at 10:37 a.m., Paul wrote, Hi, Trip. This is the latest version of the document you were looking for. Hope it's not too late. Paul.
Yeah, I know what I wrote.
Hey, I'm really looking forward to seeing you guys tonight. Oh, yeah. Circular disclosure. The information transmitted just now is intended only for the person or entity to which it is addressed, and it may contain confidential and or privileged material. Any review, retransmission...
I don't know what that means.
Inbox full.
That's what he said.
Hey, what's this poker game I hear about this weekend?
Who's that guy?
You mean to bring anything, or...
I meant to invite a different David. Rain check?
Email can be frustrating, but that's probably because you're trying to use it for the wrong things, like
Whatever I said as this 19 points, it's being summarized, except that Nigerian communication is. So now, finally, to report. So reporting, that is, we write reports, or we teach students to write reports after industrial visit or after attending a conference, or we write reports after organizing programs. So sometimes, you know, as a editor of the campus newsletter, some of the reports I find that they carry insufficient or they are incomplete. So all necessary information, they are not provided. Sometimes I need to call people and ask them for additional information. Okay. So I thought I will touch upon this very briefly. So any report, you can have it for 5 paragraphs. So don't write as a long paragraph. So you divide your report into 5. So first paragraph, you give all the information. In case of industrial visit, you can say who went to the industrial visit, how many students, so that is who went in the case, which class, first year or second year, how many of them went, where they went, when they went, why, as a part of co-curricular activity. So in that particular office, which division they visited. So all the information, these informations you give, information you give in the first paragraph. So in case of programs attended, similarly there again, so the first paragraph should answer questions like who, what, when, all WH question, when, why, how, all these information need to be given in the first paragraph. So what is the name of the program? Who organized the program? When, where they organized? So all these details in the first paragraph. Similarly, when you organize a program, in the first paragraph, you write what is the name of the program, whether it is an AICT sponsored or DST sponsored. So whether sponsored, how many days you organized the program. Here, I just wanted to say, the use of numerical objectives. Many says it is a 2 days workshop, So it is a two-day workshop is the right way of saying. So even in the banner, okay, we find this. So 2 days workshop, it is wrong. It's a numerical adjective where you say two-day workshop. So how many days, when, where, how many participated, who the participants are. So all these details must be there in the first paragraph. So here in industrial visit, okay, what, so again, takeaway. So if you are asked to write a report on this session, so you can say that the takeaway is 7 C's of communication. So yeah, do's and don'ts during email communication and nuances of report writing. So these will be the 3 paragraphs. Okay. So in the first paragraph, you will explain the 7 C's you have learned. So what was learned, takeaway 2, that is email etiquette. So you can point out something very, you find very pertinent. Okay, and what was pertinent thing you learned in writing reports. Then summary with overall effectiveness. So you must train the students to write, to identify at least 3 takeaways from their industrial visit, what they learned. And in each paragraph, ask them to elaborate, that is each takeaways. And first sentence, you ask them to frame in such a way that the reader understand what is dealt with in that particular paragraph. So you, we have to train the students in this way. And final paragraph on the overall effectiveness of the industrial visit. So this is how we, you can give them a template and ask them to write, and then you can correct it and give them, so that it will be of a practice to them even when they do projects at a later stage. So project reports also, the body of the project's report, they can do it very well if you train them like this. So programs attended, objective of the program here, its usefulness at the workplace. So what, so how that is going to be of use to you. So the programs you attended that was organized by some other institution. So if it is a 2-day program or 3-day program, you can say day wise. Day one, who was the resource person, was what was dealt with, what did you learn? If it is session wise, session one, what you learned, who was the resource person, their affiliation, learning points. So when you give a report, so whoever it is, maybe for campus news or for college aspirations or for a college brochure, so anything, people must be able to, so from single report, that should satisfy the needs of any reporter or editor. So day-wise, so session-wise details, finally, summary with your feedback about the program you attended. So when you organize, okay, objective of the program, then you can also say how it will be useful for the teaching fraternity or student community. Then you can again say the day-wise, session-wise, and finally, you summarize your report with the gist of participant feedback. So these are the points I just wanted to say regarding report writing, because it should be very clear. It should be self-explanatory. So it should not demand your reader to call you and ask for further information. So it should be self-sufficient, self-explanatory. So that is how you have to draft your report. So with this, I'm closing the session. If there are any questions, you can feel free to ask. I'm sorry. So in that, ma'am, you have anything here? Nagalakshmi ma'am, thank you. Well explained, colorful and impressive slides. Thank you, ma'am. Uh, It's a very good session. This is probably the ice on the cake. It is MN, I am not able to figure out. Thank you, ma'am. Nice presentation. Thank you. Thanks a lot. Banati, ma'am, you have got anything to say?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, Dr. Jaya. Today we had an informative and interactive session. May I request Dr. Banureka, QOD Fashion Technology Department, to deliver the closing note. Banureka, ma'am, over to you.
Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am, Banureka, ma'am.
Yeah, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am, yes.
So, a very pleasant good evening to all of you. Jaya, ma'am, that was a wonderful presentation from you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
So, effective communication is a key interpersonal skill. So, based on this only, we are going to improve the relationship, the rapport with our colleagues, with our higher ups. And based on this, I think it is about us. So every day we try to practice this. I think we still had lots of things new to learn from you. And though we know, sometimes we don't follow them due to lack of time or hastily doing things. So that way we try to miss certain things. So it was the session was more of like, you know, emptying our cup totally and refilling it. So thank you so much for giving those 7 C's, and it's more easier for us to understand also, being very clear, concise, concrete, correct, coherent, complete, and courteous. So that was a wonderful way to remember all the points, ma'am. Thank you so much for that. And of course, all those email etiquettes, all of them, all those mistakes, at least once, at least each mistake was done by all of us. So we did correct them. But the way we go out, no, we just check all the switches and we check the cylinder, if it's all if it's switched off. The same way, I think we'll have to take a lot of preparations before sending an email. Very hastily we send a mail, and sometimes we think that we have sent the mail, but then we don't have clicked the send button even. So many times we have missed sending the mails also. So that was a very quick checklist which you gave us for us to send proper and correct emails. The email etiquettes, that's very, very important. Many of them do those mistakes. Thank you for that also, ma'am. And the last one, the nuances of report writing. So when you told that, I remember how many times you've called me to get more information for the report. So we will have to keep them also right. So thank you so much for that wonderful presentation, and very, very beautifully explained. And the main thing is, I love the way you took examples from our routine day-to-day life. Like, you know, though all those conversations were something which we have done in our college at KCG. So it was so, you know, we could relate ourselves to it. So thank you so much, ma'am. We will try to keep up the whole thing so that our system is more, we work with more clarity. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thanks to all the audience also. A wonderful session.
Thank you, Banureka, ma'am, for elaborate feedback. So this being the final session, I would like to thank the management as well as the participants who are in absentia also. Many are not here for this session. So I thank all of them for your patient listening. So I wish that the takeaways from every session is implemented in our classroom and our students get benefited out of it. So on behalf of the organizing team, that is Dr. Vanathi, Dr. Praveen, Revati ma'am, I thank each one of you for your cooperation in organizing this FTP. Thank you very much.